Today on BRStv, you thought that you had this alkalinity thing down, but it's time for the next level. There's another 70% to be found here. Today we're going after it, and your tank will thank you. Hey, this is Ryan with BRStv's Master Series, diving that gap between good, great, and all that progress left on the table. When I started reefing, I was told calcium was more important than alkalinity, which turned out to be wrong. Then I was told alkalinity is just a buffer for pH, which also turned out to be wrong. Eventually, it was clear that alkalinity is actually half the calcium carbonate equation, and then why alkalinity's buffering effect and the related higher pH is the gas pedal that fuels growth, or maybe better put, avoids the low pH that is actually the e-brake that slows everything down. But what level is best? When I started reefing, I was told natural seawater parameters around 7 dKH were best. Then no, elevated levels around 12 dKH are best. No wait, natural seawater levels are best again. Or maybe it just doesn't matter at all. Anywhere in that range is fine. Today, we master alkalinity, get to the bottom of all this, and find that next level of success. I'm gonna tell you right now that after evaluating all of this, I run my tanks at a dKH alkalinity of 9. In a few minutes, I think it'll be obvious why. Fair warning, today's video is a bit reef nerdy, but if you can get to the other side of this, you'll understand alkalinity better than a vast majority of reefers. Not only will your tank thank you, but everyone who you share this information with will thank you as well. First, why do we maintain alkalinity to begin with? Two reasons. First one is maintaining alkalinity will make maintaining pH easier. If you watched our Master Oxygen, Hydrogen, and pH episode, you already know that maintaining a proper pH will increase health, longevity, and growth as much as 50%. Or more accurately put, maintaining less than ideal pH will actually decrease coral health, related growth, by as much as 50%. Second, as you'll find out in just a moment, alkalinity test kits are effectively used to test how much bicarbonate and carbonate is in the water. This is most important because carbon is half of what makes up the coral's calcium carbonate skeletal structure. Increase or decrease availability absolutely has a direct impact on the formation of that skeletal structure and growth. Something that we clearly identified in our BRStv investigates on elevated elements where we achieve 70% more growth with elevated levels. The answer to the most obvious next question is, what if I maintain elevated alkalinity levels and a proper pH? Do those effects compound to over 100%, and is the effect exponential over time? The answer is almost certainly, and something that we plan on testing in a BRStv investigates in the future. Whether or not you want to achieve that is up to you, but understanding the science behind how that is achieved will be the basis for that decision. In that spirit, if there's only one thing that you come away with from today's episode, let it be the difference between testing pH and testing alkalinity, but also the relationship of how they're tied together. I challenged myself to simplify this relationship, make it digestible and easier to understand, but likely less than 5% of reefers currently understand how pH and alkalinity relate to each other in a reef tank, or how to use that information to find progress in the tank. I think we can change all that and make this common knowledge that forms the next evolution of reefing. So diving right into the foundation of today's discussion, the difference between testing pH and testing alkalinity. pH is a measurement of the tank's acidity, but more accurately put, pH is a measurement of the concentration or amount of hydrogen ions in the water. The more hydrogen ions, the more acidic the water will be. Just for reference, most ocean reefs have a healthy pH of around 8.2 or 8.3. However, many of our tanks drop as low as 7.8. Those tanks closer to 7.8 have a higher concentration of hydrogen ions and more acidic than nature. The corals in a 7.8 pH tank will survive and even grow, but this is an area where the difference between good approaches and great approaches shows up. You should expect slower growth, thinner, weaker coral and invert skeletons, reduced resistance to stress-based mortalities, and reduced larval sediment, which I believe is most commonly experienced with challenges promoting the spread and health of coralline algae. Reducing the concentration of hydrogen ions in the water raises that pH up and solves all of that with minimal effort to fix it and has one of the highest returns in our hobby. So where does that excess or increased concentration of hydrogen ions come from? We shared this in detail in our pH oxygen hydrogen video a few weeks ago, but a vast majority of that acidity and excess hydrogen in the water is a net result of carbon dioxide in the air of the room entering the tank through gas exchange on the surface of the tank's water or protein skimmer. We haven't explained why that is or how it works before, but this is the heart of how alkalinity works in the tank, so it's valuable to understand. How carbon dioxide or CO2 affects a tank's acidity is best explained in a three-step process. Step one, when carbon dioxide enters the tank via the surface water or skimmer, the CO2 and the water, or H2O, combine to create carbonic acid. You can see this is a one-for-one transformation. The H2O and the CO2 have a total of 2 hydrogens, 3 oxygens, and 1 carbon. Combine them all together has the same number. They're just arranged differently to create a new compound, carbonic acid. This is a concept that you'll see throughout today's video, a simple rearrangement of elements to create something brand new. Step 2, at a normal reef tank pH, the reaction that immediately follows is much of that carbonic acid that was just created instantly disassociates, splits off the hydrogen ion, and creates bicarbonate. The net result of that equation is a free hydrogen ion in the water. Since pH is a direct measurement of hydrogen ions and acidity, the newly created free hydrogen ion lowers the pH of the water and increases acidity. As more CO2 enters the tank, creates more bicarbonate, and nets out an increased amount of hydrogen ions, the more downward pressure there is on pH. Step 3 is a small portion of the newly formed bicarbonate can then further disassociate into carbonate and lose yet another hydrogen ion, further increasing the number of hydrogen ions in the water, increasing acidity, and decreasing the pH. So this might be the first time you ever even considered hydrogen ions in your reef tank, and you don't actually need to understand that entire process if you take away this one thing from the conversation. Carbon dioxide in your home is a number one contributor to your tank's acidity. You, your family, and pets breathing will result in elevated CO2 in your home and lower your tank's pH. Raising your pH back up means solving or combating that. I'll show you several ways to do that with alkalinity in just a moment. Okay, this is where the term alkalinity comes in. The most basic explanation is alkalinity is a measurement of the ability to buffer the water against acids that would otherwise reduce the pH. Buffer essentially meaning soak up all those excess hydrogens from the water. The higher the alkalinity level, the more buffer and capacity for excess hydrogen there is, and in turn, more stable pH. What this means for your reef tank is if you maintain proper alkalinity ranges in your tank somewhere between 7 and 12 DKH, it will increase the water's ability to soak up the excess acidity from CO2 in the room, and lower tank pHs are less likely to materialize as an issue. However, it also means if you let alkalinity drop below 7 DKH or don't maintain it, the buffer system will be weak, easily overwhelmed, and acidity or low pH is going to be a major health issue for your tank. Okay, so understanding the importance of that buffer system, what is it made of? It's largely based on the bicarbonate and carbonate in the water. So when you test alkalinity of your tank with your test kit or checker, around 97% of what you're checking in the water is carbonate alkalinity, which is a combination of about 90% bicarbonate, about 7% carbonate, and then 3% borate and other. To understand how this buffer system works, or hydrogen ion sink works, imagine a tank where we add acid, which creates those free hydrogen ions, increases acidity. Since pH is a measurement of those hydrogen ions, the pH will drop fairly dramatically. However, if we maintain proper carbonate alkalinity with an appropriate level of carbonate and bicarbonate to soak up those hydrogens, something different happens and pH is not affected in the same way. So after adding the acid and increasing the hydrogen ions, rather than dramatically lowering the pH, the carbonate picks up that free hydrogen to become bicarbonate. And then the bicarbonate may pick up another hydrogen to become carbonic acid. So you can see as this happens, the carbonate alkalinity soaking up the excess hydrogen ions to create a dramatically reduced impact on pH. As I mentioned earlier, that process of carbonic acid transitioning to bicarbonate and then carbonate has arrows in both directions, constantly changing forms. However, there is an equilibrium where it becomes stable. That natural equilibrium is largely based on how much CO2 or carbon dioxide is in your room and then the carbonic acid that it contributes to the tank. That effect and stability point is measured and based on tank pH, which again is that measurement of how many of those hydrogen ions are floating around in the tank. If the pH drops below 7.8, there's an abundance of them, and almost all of the carbonate will pick up a hydrogen and become bicarbonate, nearly eliminating the availability of that important carbonate, which is easier to use for the corals. On top of that, more of the bicarbonate will transition to carbonic acid, eventually overwhelming the buffer system. However, if we raise the pH back to an ideal tank pH of 8.3 and reduce the concentration of hydrogen in the tank, the lack of hydrogen ions creates pressure to transition carbonic acid back to bicarbonate and then back to carbonate as well. Now that story is if you maintain a stable pH, that balance in the buffer system will find an equilibrium and be stable as well. In turn, a stable alkalinity, the heart of how we maintain a stable pH. So you can see while pH and alkalinity measurements are entirely different things, they're completely dependent on each other. If you didn't catch all that entirely, don't worry. The most important part of this is know that you cannot solve pH issues if you don't maintain alkalinity first. The higher end of that 7 to 12 GKH range, simply more effective because 12 GKH water has more alkalinity in it to soak up the excess acid in the water. If you remember from earlier, I recommend a GKH of 9. This next part is why. So here's the challenge of the day. The importance of the alkalinity system is probably obvious now. However, there's an issue. What levels do we maintain? And the fact that the corals, coralline algae and inverts, are constantly soaking up alkalinity from the water to create their skeletal base made of calcium carbonate. Before I get to why I believe a 9 GKH is best, we need to address the fact that in an average low to medium demand reef tank, the corals reduce the GKH by a half a point a day, meaning it could be a 3.5 drop in a week. But some super heavy stocked SPS dominant tanks can have a 2 GKH alkalinity drop in a single day. This happens because the coral skeletal structure is made of calcium carbonate, corals pulling calcium ions and carbonate or bicarbonate ions out of the water to create calcium carbonate. So the corals are the single biggest soak of carbonate alkalinity in the tank. They suck up the tank's buffer every day and it needs to be replaced. That's often done with two parts based on sodium bicarbonate and sodium carbonate, which are obvious direct additions of carbonate and bicarbonate to the tank, and probably why two parts are the easiest to dose, tweak, test, and manage alkalinity with. But there are other options like calcium hydroxide, sodium hydroxide, calcium formate, and calcium reactors as well, all of which will work each of these alkalinity additive systems better for different situations, budgets, and skill levels. If I had to pick one alkalinity additive solution as a general recommendation to 80% of the reefers out there, it would be a two-part system because it's the easiest to understand, easiest to test for, and make small immediate adjustments to, plenty of affordable options, low risk of equipment-based failures or overdoses, and it's also the safest. However, there are other reasons to pick different alkalinity dosing options. One of them relates directly to today's topic, and that's almost all of them will have a temporary impact on the tank's pH, which may be desirable to a lot of people. In fact, if you have trouble maintaining pH in your tank, the effect on pH might be the number one determining factor in picking an alkalinity additive. So let's dive in headfirst in how two parts, sodium and calcium hydroxide, calcium reactors, and calcium formate affect pH. Starting with two parts, the alkalinity portion of some two parts is just sodium bicarbonate. In many cases, you can just read the back of the label to see what it contains. When you add sodium bicarbonate to the tank, a vast majority will stay in the bicarbonate form with a single hydrogen attached. However, a small portion will lose a hydrogen and become carbonate. That newly created hydrogen ion will temporarily have a small lowering impact on pH. Dosing sodium bicarbonate as your alkalinity additive is a simple, safe, and effective way of increasing alkalinity, but dosing sodium bicarbonate does have a small, temporary reduction in pH associated with it. Again, when that bicarbonate splits off that hydrogen to form carbonate, the new free hydrogen will have that small lowering effect on pH, small because only a small portion of the bicarbonate will change form, and often lowering the pH less than a tenth of a point. Temporary means the effect will only last a few hours. The tank will gas off some of the CO2 and find its original equilibrium. However, it's much more popular to dose sodium carbonate, often referred to as soda ash, as the daily alkalinity additive because it will have an often desirable elevating effect on pH. In this case, when you dose the sodium carbonate to the water, a vast majority of the carbonate, around 90% of it, will pull a hydrogen from the water to form bicarbonate. That reduction of hydrogen in the tank's water will raise the tank's pH significantly, often a few tenths of a point in a single dose, and why this type of two-part is often dosed slowly in a dripper or with a dosing pump spread over the day. However, this effect is also temporary and may only last half the day or so, depending on how often and how much you dose it. Eventually, the CO2 will be absorbed from the surrounding room and that equilibrium restored. However, a daily dose of two-part is a way to continually bind up those hydrogen ions daily, combat that effect, and then maintain a consistently higher pH. If you're wondering what your commercial two-part is made up from, it's often predominantly sodium bicarbonate mixed with a small amount of sodium carbonate to make a pH-neutral mix that has minimal to no effect on your tank's pH. This eliminates a small temporary pH drop as well as the need to dose it slowly. You don't get the pH benefits, but for something that's sold on a shelf with minimal guidance on how to use it safely and effectively, this approach is probably wise. If you want to know definitively what your two-part is made up from, dose some of the tank and monitor the tank's pH. It will be easy to identify. If it's sodium bicarbonate, there'll be a small drop in pH. If it's a blend, it'll probably stay the same or very close to. And if it's predominantly sodium carbonate, there'll be a significant increase in pH. Next up, the hydroxides, meaning calcium hydroxide, known in reefing as kalkwasser, and sodium hydroxide, known as lye. In this case, when the solution containing sodium or calcium hydroxide ionizes or separates in the water, the hydroxide, which is a single oxygen with one hydrogen, essentially combines with carbon dioxide in the tank to create bicarbonate. Reducing the available carbon dioxide in the tank reduces the production of carbonic acid and those free hydrogen ions that lower the pH. This reduction results in a new pH alkalinity equilibrium, again temporary, because over the next day or so, new carbon dioxide will be reintroduced into the tank, but dosed daily in an ongoing way, it will elevate the pH consistently. An increase in pH dosing with hydroxides is often dramatic and higher than most two parts. I've used calcium hydroxide as my primary calcium and alkalinity additive many, many, many times, and used correctly, I believe, generally safe, easy to use, and effective. In fact, in upcoming Master Kalkwasser episode, you'll see why I believe it to be one of the best calcium and alkalinity solutions out there. I do feel a bit differently about sodium hydroxide. There's some DIY sodium hydroxide or lye-based two parts, and maybe even some commercial two parts out there that at least use partial amounts of sodium hydroxide. My only caution here is sodium hydroxide is lye and it is dangerous. The warning signs on the containers are real, and I personally wouldn't recommend anyone use it unless they have experience with chemical safety and know how to keep yourself and your family safe mixing, using, and storing it. If you're confident in your safety procedures, then it will raise the tank's pH more than most common two parts. In fact, I believe recommending dry lye as a reef tank solution to others would be somewhat reckless unless I could be certain the person I was advising knew how to use it safely. Every chemical has a safety risk attached to it, but this one more than others, and I don't believe a tenth of a point or two is enough benefit. Next is calcium reactor. This one's a bit interesting because it involves intentionally dosing carbon dioxide into a reactor to intentionally create higher concentration of carbonic acid to melt old coral skeleton back into its original elements of calcium and form a carbon, and then dose it back to the tank. While it's a highly effective solution, there's no way around it. With a canister of CO2 and a calcium reactor, you're intentionally dosing carbonic acid to the tank, which is going to lower the pH of the tank to some degree. How big of a deal this will depend on the amount of CO2 in your home already, gas exchange in your tank, size of the tank, and how it's tuned. That said, there are many situations where a calcium reactor is the best solution for other issues, and something that we'll cover in our Master Calcium Reactor series. There's also alkalinity addition options which have no effect on pH. The most recent and most popular seems to be Tropic Marin's All for Reef and Carbocalcium, which are based on calcium formate. In this case, the formate part is the alkalinity contributor. However, it's a much more complex process involving bacteria converting formate into carbonate alkalinity. This is also a fairly in-depth conversation, so I wouldn't be surprised if we released a Master Calcium Formate episode by the time that we're done with the Master Chemistry series. Regardless of how you maintain alkalinity, I promised I'd explain why 9 DKH is my recommended level. Generally, I'd say natural seawater levels are best for most elements, which in this case is 7 DKH. Here's a reason why that's not the case here. None of the other element levels drop as fast in concentration as alkalinity. Most of them also don't have a dramatic effect on the overall chemistry or pH or buffering system when they're low as well. So the first part of suggesting a 9 DKH as a better level than 7 is simply you're further away from danger. Pretty much everyone agrees that going below 7 is very bad for the tank. So going somewhat higher is the answer, but how much higher? The answer is recognizing how it might fall below 7. Inside a year, there are only a few, but when you think long-term, there are too many to count. Starting with hobby-grade test kits are not designed for absolute accuracy. They're designed to get you consistently close. The quality of the kit, chemistry it uses, accuracy with how you perform it, how you choose to read that endpoint, stated degree of accuracy on the kit, age of kit. In reality, some batches of the kits are just better than others over the years. Meaning, if you shoot for an exact 7, it'll be hard to achieve with a hobby-grade kit. If all those challenges combined to just 15% inaccuracy when the test kit reads 7, it could be just as easy 6 or 8 or even worse. Also, what happens when our dosing container runs dry and we didn't notice? Maybe the two-part dosing pump stops working. You run out of your CO2 on your calcium reactor, calc pump dies. how many days do you want before real issues show up in the tank? In this case, I want some buffer from those challenges, and experience tells me 2 DKH seems like the minimum. However, on the other side of the equation is how high is too high? We've run experiments here on elevated levels, which include as high as 12 DKH, common with salts like Red Sea's Coral Pro. There's no question that the 12 DKH achieve much faster growth versus the controlled closer to natural seawater levels, likely due to the fact that with a 12 DKH, it has near double the amount of carbonate and bicarbonate in the water as a DKH of 7. Specifically, that increased availability of the theoretically easier to use carbonate, there's very little carbonate in the water, and relative to its counterpart of calcium, even very little bicarbonate, so nearly doubling the availability of either by going from 7 to 12 is a big deal, and it's very easy to understand why in our BRStv investigates, our elevated level tanks experience so much more growth. So running 12 DKH is attractive to many reefers, particularly those with new tanks filled with tiny frags and trying to grow them out faster. However, at 12 DKH, it's also riding the edge. What happens when testing or equipment failure raises it up to 14? It's not really known what the total effect of carbon and alkalinity that high is. At some point, it's certainly bad for the corals and fish. Also, if you're growing skeletal structure dramatically faster, you also need to compensate for that with soft tissue formation going into turbo speed, meaning lighting, energy production, sources of protein, building blocks of protein with aminos, nitrogen, phosphorus, trace elements, all that regulate photosynthesis and protein production all need to be capable of producing tissue that fast. It can be done, but this approach is riding the edge and I believe has a higher percentage of failure in the long run. So for me, 9 DKH seems to be that middle ground where the tank is best protected from testing errors, dosing mistakes, and equipment failure. Also captures some of that increased growth from elevated levels, but isn't chasing the growth dragon, buffers the pH better, and stays away from some of the bigger precipitation issues as well. So anywhere between 7 and 12 DKH is a good solution capable of a solid tank. My priority is long-term success that acknowledges the inevitable and accounts for it. I believe 9 DKH is a great level for me where I can find increased growth, long-term success, and the progress left on the table. In any case, I'm certain you can use today's information to identify what you believe is great for your tank and share it because the community wants to know. I just mentioned precipitation a moment ago. That's where we're going next. Master calcium, magnesium in our reef tanks, finding that balance, how to manage super saturated water, what causes precipitation and at what point, how much of the precipitation in our tanks is just theoretical and how much is real and you'll actually experience. On top of that, what's being left on the table? The answer is that in our Master Reef Tank Chemistry series on magnesium and calcium here, and all of our Master series on our channel right here.